Cops and robbers have been one of the most impactful genres on television, showcasing good and bad, right and wrong. But the criminals offered by Hollywood are usually black and brown, leaving audiences all over the world with a negative perception of minorities. In this episode of Culture Conversations, I talked to Rashad Robinson, the president of Color of Change, one of the world's largest social justice organizations, about how they're pushing Hollywood to change that narrative. So I want to talk to you a little bit about Hollywood and what the Color of Change is doing to change the representation of Black people on television. You've called for the entertainment industry to distance itself from police, saying the first step is to remove cops off sets, whether they are paid writing consultants, paid security. Can you talk to me a little bit about that?
What I think a lot of people are waking up to is all of the ways in which policing in this country doesn't work. That it's about control, that it has supported violence. And time again, police and police departments and police unions have had a chance to fix this and they failed. And so the question for Hollywood, which oftentimes at award shows or red carpets, we hear the political views, we will have people railing against Trump, but what are you doing about Trumpism? What are you doing about all of the sort of ways in which, the sort of story that is told in this country about justice, about equality is not full and not fair. And so we've got to do some hard looks at what side of this are you on. And so for Hollywood, they have a real opportunity. As they're putting out hashtag Black Lives Matter, as they're saying that they stand with the movement to drive for real change in this country, here are some things that they can actually do. And we're not alone, right? We're standing with a whole range of folks inside the industry that have sort of called on this. Kendrick Sampson, the actor, and his organization Build Power has been doing work around this. Others have been raising their voices. So I just want to say that we sit inside of an ecosystem of folks that are giving Hollywood an invitation to actually put some action behind their words. And until we actually get to a situation where law enforcement is not about control, but about safety and about justice, then we have to hold a standard for who should be allowed on sets, who should be in these places, because it doesn't mean safety for everyone.
Now, are the cops that are on sets, are paid writing consultants, are they influencing what we're seeing on some of these shows?
The folks on set are absolutely influencing these shows. We did a study with USC Norman Lear School, really looking at the representation of race and crime. The report was called Normalizing Injustice. And we looked at all the crime TV shows on air and really sort of dug into this world that is actually very diverse on air. It's a world where racial diversity exists, but racism seems not to exist. You know, and this is a deep, deep problem where you have sort of representations of crime day in and day out, representations of justice, representations of the system that are just wholly inaccurate, that only prioritize and only show it from the vantage point of police, which we know time and time again has not been a truthful representation. It has real world impacts. One of the real world impacts is illustrated through just the simple fact that for the last 20 years, violent crime has basically steadily went down in this country. And at the same time, according to Pew Research and others, Americans believe violent crime is going up. So we have a gap between perception and reality, and that gap is harming us in deep ways. It's creating demands for the type of policing that actually doesn't keep us safe when we actually need investments in our communities, schools, healthcare, parks, things that we know that communities are safe actually have. And so to the extent that, you know, if you only have one type of consultant on these sets, and those consultants can constantly tell a story through their vantage point, what we're going to continue to get is season after season of crime shows that paint sort of a hero law enforcement figure, criminal black and brown person, and no sort of understanding of all the ways in which the system does not work and the system operates in ways that harms us.
Shows like Law and Order, The Blacklist, Chicago PD, the list goes on and on. You said these shows have an agenda. How so?
They do have an agenda. You know, I remember about a year ago at the Television Critics Association up front, Dick Wolf said that his shows are apolitical. Right. And Dick Wolf is sort of the famous person behind Law and Order and so many of the sort of crime TV genres. And he said his shows are apolitical. Right. The idea that he could create a show about race, about crime, about justice, about cities, and that there would be no politics behind it means that he had to have his head in the sand. And when I talk about these shows having an agenda, what I'm saying is that they are making a choice not to show the police officers raping women suspects. They're making a choice to not show the sort of police brutalities. They're making a choice to show activists as people who want some sort of ulterior motive. I sort of oftentimes wonder how these shows would have showed the SNCC organizers and the organizers of the 60s if they were set in that time, because they oftentimes create this world where no activism is needed in those that are pushing back at the system. They have this magical world, right? And I think I sometimes joke about it, but it actually I think is really representative of the problem. They show this world where there's way more black judges than exist in the real world. So if you've seen one of these crime shows, you'll know that they have a lot of black judges. And I am not trying to come for those brothers and sisters' jobs. But what I am trying to say here is that if you have a writer's room that is overwhelmingly white, and then you just create a symbolic black judge and you send justice to their mouths to help us make us think that justice is actually being served, you don't actually examine race and racism. You don't have that judge sort of have an opinion about sort of the justice system. What would it be like for a 65-year-old black woman to actually be a judge? And what would the pathway for her to actually get there look like? And what these shows do, right, and the reason why we called it what we called it is that they normalize injustice. They make the day-to-day sort of injustice of our system seem like it's okay. These shows, day in and day out, show the good guy, the sort of hero, doing things that are illegal, doing things that are unjust, doing things that are deep violations, and then they get sort of a Hollywood speech to say why the ends justified the means. So a show that constantly is showing us that police brutality, that illegal surveillance, that all of these things are justified in order to keep Americans safe, when we know, in fact, it doesn't keep us safe, and so many of us are deeply unsafe as a result, then we know that that is sort of the definition of agenda.
You know, and that brings up this, TV shows like Cops and Live PD were abruptly canceled. What role did The Color of Change play in getting those shows canceled, or did they play a role?
Well, we played a role in getting both of those canceled. I mean, Cops, we go way back with. We had to get it canceled back in 2013. And then, you know, the show popped back up into syndication. And when it popped up back in syndication, you know, we at that point weren't able to sort of get it to budge. And then over the course of the last several months, as we've been able to renew some of these conversations, we were able to open up conversations with Paramount, open up conversations with A&E, open up conversations with other networks about these reality TV show cop shows, the ones that create a contract and a relationship with police that they're only going to show them one way. These shows that go into poor communities and show the impacts of the war on drugs, on poverty. These cameras are not going to Capitol Hill or Wall Street or places where sometimes crime is happening that really impacts us at a structural level. They're going to communities that are already targeted, under attack, exploited. They're bringing cameras and they're showing that the sort of somehow these police officers are keeping us safe in deep ways, when really to keep us safe would be investments in those communities, helping those communities have access to healthcare and education and economic development. And so those TV shows have an agenda, and we went to those networks and we went to those studios in this moment and said, hey, if you want to have a conversation about Black Lives Matter, then you need to stop putting stuff on your air that makes it much harder for our lives to matter.
But with that being said, what is the impact of crime shows on American policing? What are the findings?
So the findings show that they create this idea that policing is working just fine, that the system is working fine, and that, you know, so many people watch these shows that they're way more powerful at times than an op-ed piece we can write. But they're not, I think, as powerful as our movement. And the movement that has been growing around the country and people taking to the streets, I think has opened up a new conversation inside of Hollywood about the content that they're putting out in the air. You know, in Cook County, we worked to elect a new district attorney, a first Black woman district attorney. And she went in and she started to make some real changes. In particular, she stopped incarcerating on certain crimes, like low-level offenses, like petty theft and driving infractions. And she, you know, made those changes, and it was going to impact the police officers, you know, overtime. So Kim Fox, the district attorney, she does that. And the next thing we see is we see the Fraternal Order of Police march on her office, the police union. Now, that's their right. Actually, that's the First Amendment right. But they marched on her office with four white nationalist groups, according to the Chicago Sun-Times. I wrote about it in the New York Times, and it was all fact-checked. They marched publicly with four white nationalist groups. They took out the picture of the first Black woman district attorney who is trying to bring more safety and justice, and whether or not you agree with her politics, they took out her face and they rubbed it on her crotches. And then those same police officers the next day put on their uniforms, their badges, and their guns, and they went back into our communities to protect and to serve. And so when we want to have a conversation about what does it mean to recognize that we need to change the system, we actually need those type of stories on our TV, not just stories that police all day are catching the bad guy. Stories that actually show that there is a deep flawed structure, incentive structure with policing, where we have police officers doing things that they're not supposed to be doing. We send people with a gun to solve a lot of problems. And so the TV shows make it seem like all day they're solving crimes, when in fact, that's not actually what they're doing. And if we don't actually tell the full story, we end up with a situation where we have people asking for the wrong things. Mm-hmm. And you know, I sometimes hear people say, well, it's TV, Rashad. It's make-believe. Why are you taking it so seriously? And for a lot of those folks, I say this. I say if medical shows were putting out inaccurate information about cancer or HIV and AIDS or diabetes, we would push back. We would say that was dangerous. We would say that that's impacting the public in negative ways, and we would call it out. And so why is it when shows are putting out sort of misinformation about race and crime and justice, something that is deeply dangerous to our community, do folks want to say that it's just make-believe? Because it's not make-believe for the people at the other end of those narratives, the people who day in and day out have to experience the impact of those stories.
And you know what? I want to talk about this. I want to talk about when the crime victim is Black, because I know you've heard from several writers who say they've been instructed to maybe rewrite the story to make the victim white. What does that say about the systematic racism in our country, or better yet, how we view Black people as a society in our country?
You know, one of the things we saw was that they, you know, would change the character to white because they felt like Black people wouldn't endear as much empathy. And that's a vicious cycle, right? So you don't make Black people kind of the faces of sort of empathy, and then they don't become the faces. And it goes on and on and on. You know, in particular, when it related to the sort of victims of crime, it was dismal when it came to Black women in particular. You know, we do this work in Hollywood, but we also have a criminal justice team that works around the country to change laws and advance changes in our justice system to make it more fair, to make it actually work for all of us. And one of the things that we see around the country is that certain people get prioritized as victim rights advocates. And what I mean by that is, like, when we're working to change laws, people want to hear from victims. And only certain people, only white women in particular, in many places are held up in these roles because they are over-indexed on these shows. And America thinks of them when they think of sort of a victim of a crime and who needs protection. But what we know is that Black women actually oftentimes, according to surveys and studies, want something very different out of the justice system when they're victims. They want to first and foremost want to make sure the person doesn't do it again. Then secondly, they want to make sure that there's investments in their community to make sure that violence goes down. They're more likely to want things like restorative justice or other types of programs to make sure that the person ends up on the right track, with a recognition that just sending people inside and outside of prison doesn't actually make our community safer, because it doesn't do anything to actually restore sort of the ways in which we are living, challenge poverty, mental health, so many of the other issues that are at the heart of crime in our country. And so when we don't prioritize and don't build power and don't build empathy for those voices, we end up getting solutions to problems that are not the solutions that everyone wants. They're only the solutions that certain people want. And that, right, I think, is one of the consequences of only uplifting certain people as victims. The other thing it just does is it, like, adds to this ongoing sort of way in which Black people are viewed, right? And viewed with this sort of level of hostility in our culture, this level of not seeing us as fully human and fully whole. And TV is really powerful and has a powerful role to play in doing something different.
Well, how can we fix this? Is it more Black writers in the writing room, or more people of color as showrunners and network execs?
Well, we definitely found that when you have multiple Black people in the writer's room, when you have more people of color leading these shows, it does actually mean something. But I also want to challenge white folks who are in the writer's room right now. This is not just about, this is about diversifying your writer's room, and it's about doing better yourself. It's about also recognizing that, you know, Black folks have to, like, know a lot of different things in order to be successful, and have to be experts in a lot of different things. And oftentimes white folks, white writers, white folks can be like, oh, well, that's the people of color's job. Like, I don't actually have to know that. And so I want to, like, challenge folks that your job should be to have some deeper level of expertise beyond the community that you're part of, because Black people don't get to be successful in this work by only being knowledgeable about their own area. I say that as well to say that we need the industry to start tracking the numbers. They need to start tracking the content. We need the industry to start ensuring that there's people who are social workers and are activists and are public defenders and have other experiences that are inside of these writers' rooms. All of this has to be part of how we rebalance the system that has really created a whole genre of television shows that are nothing more than PR arms for police in a society that, if anyone has been paying attention over the last several months, police don't need PR. Police need changes to the structures and systems that they've been working inside of.
And lastly, I know you took over Lady Gaga's Instagram account with her 42.5 million Instagram followers to talk about racial injustice. How important is it to have white allies like Lady Gaga in the entertainment industry right now?
I think it's great. I think it's important that folks are opening up their platform, allowing us to reach more people. Lady Gaga, Justin Timberlake, Alyssa Milano, I think were a couple of the folks that let me sort of share some stuff on their platforms. And I know that there's been other white allies that have opened up their platform for folks like Patrice Cullors and Alicia Garza, who are co-founders of Black Lives Matter and other leaders. And so I think that trend of recognizing that folks who have built platforms and folks who have built audiences and who are white have a responsibility and opportunity, if they want to be in this work to make change, to help their folks understand and make sense of it, to bring them on the same journey that they're on. And for me, that was it was great. It was fun, and hopefully I got to share some things that sparked some new interests and some new understanding.
Absolutely. Well, thank you, Rashad. Thank you for being on the show. We really appreciate it. We cannot wait to continue to follow Color of Change, and all that you guys do is amazing. Thank you.